Thanks for monitoring.
Yeah, so we'll go ahead and get started. My name is Elizabeth Schumann. I'm the Global Education Manager for the College of Food, Ag, and Environmental Sciences. And then I'm joined by Dr. Anelli and Dr. Perry, who are going to be leading the program this summer to England. And I will let Dr. Anelli kind of get started here, talking a little bit more about the program, and just let me know when you want me to flip the slides.
Okay. Thank you, Elizabeth. Oh, you know what? But did you end up, do I have permission to advance them?
I don't know that if I can just let you advance them. If you'd rather share your screen, we can see. Do that.
It doesn't seem to, I think it might be easier because I have, if you could, can you manage to, I don't know how to do that. I'm sorry. I guess you have to do it.
Yeah. Do you want to share your screen instead?
May I do that?
Yeah, I think I just made you co-host, so.
Oh, okay. Let's get off of all the other, I don't know why we're back at that. All right. Yeah, I think that might be easier because that way I can, I have some, not animation, so, but they are, you know, they're things moving. All right, so hi again, everyone. So I'm Carol Anelli. And Dr. Kayla Perry and I are the ones offering the course at the moment. And Dr. Schumann, whom you just heard from, Elizabeth, works with all of our vendors in England to set up what Dr. Perry and I say we would like the course to be. So they do all the local arrangements for us per our instruction. So we're very, very lucky to have Elizabeth, and she and her team also know all about the finances and other particulars of things that Dr. Perry and I won't necessarily know. So it's a really good, everyone has their expertise. So Kayla and I, Dr. Perry and I know the history and science side of things, but we don't know the financial and the vendor side in England. So this is where Elizabeth comes in. So that's how this operates at the university, because we have a big education abroad group in our college and at the university as well. So everybody has their own expertise. Anyhow, what we're looking at right here is Darwin's house. It's called Down House. That's the title of our course, Evolution in Darwin's World and Ours. This is a home, by the way, that Darwin and his family, which was his wife and 10 children, lived in for the bulk of his adult life. So he was a very devoted family man and actually engaged his children in doing experiments with him. So something we'll learn about in the class a little bit. Let's see. So now let me advance the slides. Okay. So I want to remind myself to say, we do, the way the course works, we do two credits at OSU, so stateside, in the spring semester of 2024. And then we do the third credit for a total of 3 credit hours abroad in England from the 1st through the 13th of May. This course has been approved as both the legacy gen ed and the new gen ed, so that's the GEL and the GEN, for historical and cultural studies foundation course. What that means is if you need a historical and cultural studies foundation course for your gen ed program, this course will fulfill that. And if you're an honors student, you can do a little extra project. You can ask me about that at the end. And that, so it's an approved and as honors embedded course. So what do we do in the course? Well, basically the way we've set it up is those 2 credits we do stateside in the US, we do all of the learning there. There's not a lot more groundwork to be laid by the time we go abroad because we want you to be enjoying yourself and seeing everything you've read about and learned about when you were back at OSU. So what we do is we have to understand Darwin in his historical context. And what that means is the times he lived in. So society was very different in England, how religions played out, the science at the time, all of that provided the context. You can imagine, just when you think about yourself versus, say, your grandparents, their times were very different than the times we live in. You know, they didn't have the internet. They may not have even had, or they maybe great-grandparents might not have had electricity, you know, or might not have had central heating. They may have gone to a one-room schoolhouse if they were raised in a rural setting. So their context historically is very different than what we currently have. So we spend those first weeks here stateside understanding that. We look at Darwin's life and times. He lived from 1809 to 1882. We look at how he decided to do what he did, his intellectual development and what he thought about. He was very much a nature person, not a good student in the classical sense. He really didn't like being in school. He wanted to be outdoors, by the way. And then how he came to think about evolutionary theory, what was the thinking before and after him and how that influenced him. Those are those first two credit hours. Now, we use four books. They're all available as paperback. I went online and you can find these used. The sum total is about $50, give or take. So just so if you're thinking about planning and dollars are tight, which they probably are, this one, this first one was written by the historian Sandra Herbert. It was written specifically for students in college. She has excerpts from historical documents so that we don't have to try to find those. Everything is right in there. We also read Darwin's autobiography. This is very readable. He wrote it for his children and his family. But we, as historians, we understand, or when we think about historical work, we understand that it's really a memoir. It's not everything that went on in Darwin's life. And so that's why we have to look to historians to understand more. But it's very readable and in many ways funny and sweet and poignant. We also read a book by another foremost Darwin historian, Janet Brown. And Dr. Brown's book is a little paperback, but it's very good, very readable. And it's called Darwin's Origin of Species. So I want to point out, we're not reading The Origin of Species. Okay, that's a whole different beast. That's a science book. This is thinking about Darwin at the time he lived, like what we're talking about up here. You know, the railroads coming and the Industrial Revolution and all of that was very important and impactful in his time. And then lastly, we look at a modern book, Your Inner Fish. This is a fabulous book. You can get it as a paperback. There are also videos online in YouTube. There are, I think, three of them, and we have students look at those. And it shows us the influence of our evolutionary history as humans and how this plays out in our bodies today, how we, you know, the kind of problems we have, like back problems, and, you know, the fact that you can't swallow and breathe at the same time. You know, you stop breathing when you swallow a liquid or food, right? Otherwise you choke. So these are a lot of evolutionary baggage from our history. So anyway, those are the four books. They're very readable. You don't need a science background. And really the focus is historical, although you are going to come away, as we'll see, with some basic knowledge in evolution and history. So we fly in after our weeks are done here, and we do those two credits. We're all ready to go. And we are really done with the labor of the course. So we go into London, Heathrow. And just to point out that if you look down here on the mainland of Europe, Paris is like 25 miles away over the channel, and there's something called the Channel. So we have had students in the past who take the Channel from London to Paris. You can do it in a short time. It moves very fast, it goes under the water, and you come up on land and there you are in France. So it's one thing you can do. The tickets, as Elizabeth will talk more about, are open-ended. So when you buy your ticket, well, you can buy it to return at the end of the course, or you can buy it to stay longer. That second, we all go out together if you wish, but you come back, Elizabeth will talk more about that, but you can come back later than the course ends. When the course ends, you could stay on to do other things because you're already there. You've already made the trip, you know, across the pond, as we say. Okay, so that's how close the mainland is, the European mainland. When we're there, we'll land in London Heathrow, as I said. From London, we'll immediately get ourselves to Cambridge for 4 days. We'll see why that is in a minute. This is just to say, this is where Darwin finished his college degree. And then we'll also spend a day in Downhouse. This is the first picture I showed you. That's a day trip on a train and a bus out to Darwin's home. And then we'll have a week in London. So we'll look at that more closely on the next slide, I think, but I'm not going to belabor it because we will send you a document and you can look in greater detail on that. So here's the itinerary we've worked up with the vendors abroad. We leave Columbus, London is, and England and the UK here is, are 5 hours ahead of us. So we would depart on May 1st, and we return on May 13th. As I mentioned, we're coming into London Heathrow. So we have 11 nights where we're actually sleeping abroad. And these are all the things that are included into the program fee. And as you'll see on the next slide, we've kind of spelled this out a little bit more day-wise. So this is the itinerary here from the 1st to the 13th, charted out here day-wise, starting on May 1st and going to May 13th. The travel days, when you're not anywhere here, you're, you know, coming across on the plane, and here you're coming back on the plane. So you're not per se in the country till you land, for example, the next day. So these are the 4 days of this color in Cambridge. And then in that morning, we travel for 7 days to London. But that blue day is when we're in Down for Downhouse, which isn't spelled with an E. Darwin did not like to use the letter E. I'm not sure why that is. It used to be the village was spelled without an E, I think, and then they added it, but he never did for his house. Anyway, and then we have, you know, these days in London with 1 day free. By about day two in London, students feel very comfortable going off on their own when we don't have a scheduled event, and because it's very easy to do by tube and walking. So there is a free day built in here toward the end so that you can do what you wish with, you know, a teammate. We just ask that at least you go with one other person and that we know where you're headed in case anything happens. We need to know that. So I'm not going to belabor this. This is a Word document Elizabeth will send out. We'll have hyperlinks and these will be active. I could not get them to be active in this PowerPoint. I spent a long time, every workaround I could come up with. So instead, Elizabeth will send that out. Okay, so starting off then in Cambridge, that first day when we arrive, hopefully weather permitting, we'll be able to do what's called punting on the River Cam. The River Cam runs through Cambridge, so you can see where the name derived from. And we go punting on what's called the backs. Now, the way the university works, by the way, this is a medieval university. It's had its 800th anniversary, okay? It's been around a long, long time. And the only way you can see the backs, what's called the backs of the colleges, there are 31 colleges, is by taking a punt boat. And so we have people who are professional punters, often they're students and earn a couple of bucks doing this. And they take us along. And the beauty of this is we get to see the different colleges, but we also learn the history of the college. And it's the only way you can see the backs because they're private. In other words, you don't get to traipse, you know, through buildings like we can on the OSU campus. You can't do that at Cambridge. And I don't think you can do it at Oxford either. You have to be, I think, permitted in. So that's just two views on the punts. It's beautiful. There are also very good museums at the University of Cambridge. This is the Zoology Museum. And this, together with the Sedgwick Museum of Earth Sciences, so it focuses on geology. Here you're looking at some of Darwin's writings and his pen, one of his books on how coral reefs form, which his view, his theory is still solid today. He figured that out back when he was really quite young, and is before he turned 30, I think. And the Museum of Zoology has some of his insect specimens. We get to see that, but it's otherwise, it is a beautiful museum. And then there's the Whipple Museum. These are all very close to each other, and you can almost throw a stone from one to the next. Actually, in some cases you can. And this is Darwin's microscope. So we get to see these things in very short walking distance from one another. And then in Cambridge, we'll also see the Eagle Pub. Does anybody online happen to know why this is, as they say here, the most famous pub in Cambridge? Which it kind of is, actually. This is one of the rooms of it. And there's lots of stuff up on the ceiling, but that's partly why it's famous, but it really has to do with us two scientists. Anybody have an idea? Or if I say Watson and Crick, anybody know what they discovered? I realize you may not be science majors or biology majors. Well, no takers, Elizabeth, if we don't see anything in the chat. It's because this is where Watson and Crick, two British scientists back in 1953, figured out, and they used to go to this pub to talk because it was right near their laboratory, they figured out the structure of DNA. And now there's a story there that I won't dwell on, but there was a third person, a woman. And since this was 1953, they didn't treat her very well. Certainly by today's standards. And so as you could see there, this is one of the blue plaques of London. There are hundreds of these. They put them on buildings to show a significant event. And this, somebody scraped off some of the blue and wrote in "and Franklin" for Rosalind Franklin, because they wouldn't have been able to figure out the structure of DNA without her X-ray. Okay, it was X-ray diffraction crystallography, as it's called. Anyway, they didn't know how to do that, how to read her work, but they kind of stole it from her and figured it out. So this pub also has a beer they make there, a brew called Eagle's DNA for that reason. So we're going to have dinner there that first night. It's also the other reason it's very famous historically is because a lot of Royal Air Force pilots went there and they wrote their names up in the ceiling with, they smudged it with a lighter or smoke, some kind of a soot from a cigarette or a pipe or however they did it, a cigar. And they've retained that, it's preserved. So it's a very poignant place to go. A lot of these men gave their lives in World War II. Okay, now we'll also see King's College Chapel when we do a tour of Cambridge. Maybe I should move. Okay. I'm here with family, so I'm trying to talk to you with a bunch of family here. We're on a family visit. Anyway, so one of the things we'll do at Cambridge is do a three-hour tour with a local historian, meaning someone that knows the history of the university, those 800 years we talked about. And one of the things we'll see is King's College Chapel, which is world famous in part because it has the world's largest fan vault. You're seeing that piece of the ceiling here. It's a spectacular building. One of the points I could make here is all of these stained glass windows were, during World War II, they were so fearful that they would be bombed by the Nazis, that they took all of these individual stained glass pieces out and preserved them and took care of them. And so they were, you know, boarded up and then years later were replaced piece by piece, put back. So it's a spectacular thing. And here what we're seeing with all this wood, this is where the choir sits and sings and through the service that they give. And we could attend, those are free. And all these candles here, which you can barely see, will be illuminated. It's a beautiful service. Okay, and then one of my favorite things that we do is to go to the university archives. Now, the university has many archives, but the one that I've called here the Darwin Archives, that's not really the name of it. It's the university archives in the main library. And what they do at our request, because part of their mission is to instruct, not just do research. And so they take out various historical documents for us, and you're seeing them laid out here and also here in a couple of our visits, where they've taken out some letters of Darwin, some of his notebooks, photograph, various pieces of things of interest to our students. And then the historians, the archivists, people that maintain these letters, Darwin had a voluminous correspondence They have gone through and annotated them all, and they're available online. And we work with those online documents when we're stateside. But then when we go abroad, we actually get to see the real documents. So it's quite a thrill for the students to, and for me as well, the instructors, to get to see this. And you're seeing some of Darwin's a letter, I think it is, here. So these are all carefully preserved in acid-free paper and so forth. Okay, and another thing we do is go to the Cambridge Botanic Garden. This was just getting started when Darwin was a student at Cambridge. And not only are these beautiful and historic, but and they do have plantings that date back to Darwin's time. But they're also famous because Darwin's mentor was John Stevens Henslow. And Henslow was the one who started these gardens. And so some of the trees that we'll see and that this gentleman here is telling us about, this local guide, and they're very good at what they do. The guides have to go through a test to be able to be guides at the Cambridge Botanic Garden. He will explain to us the plantings and the history of it, and it's they're just beautiful. So here you see the guide talking to us. Another thing we do at Cambridge is go to the Orchard Tea Garden. And here you're seeing the River Cam. I don't know if you can see right here is a punt boat, but you'll see other pictures of this. This is about a 40 or 50 minute walk out of Cambridge. It's very popular with the locals. And you can see the University of Cambridge is up here. So we take this footpath. Now, in the history of the UK and England, when they had a series of order called enclosure acts, that meant that they took over a lot of what were the public areas for having their farm animals go out and pasture. And when those got taken over, they allowed people, you had to give way to foot traffic. So there are all kinds of footpaths all around and trails all around the UK, including around Cambridge University. And so one can find these on maps, on Google Maps, for example. That's what I'm showing you here, the footpath to go from the University of Cambridge to Grantchester. Now, Grantchester, even though in addition to it being a beautiful, idyllic place, it's also very famous historically, which I'll tell you about in a second. This particular walk, by the way, for whatever reason, is called by the locals the Grind. This is a walk you can take. And this is part of it. You can see you go through these tree-covered areas, and that's one of the footpaths there. We have lunch there. And here you see some of the students on a warm, sunny day out with a punt boat and also this float boat. You know, they have a good time. This is the end of the semester when I was there. So exams were over and the students were, you know, basically partying because they've had to pass all their exams and they've done so. And you can see a punter here and here, these long poles that they use to punt across the river, which is what we'll do that first day when we have someone punt for us. This is not an easy thing to do, especially up in Cambridge at the university where there are many, many punt boats at one time and you don't want to get jammed up in them and fall over into the water, which is why we have them do this for us. Anyway, the Orchard Tea Garden itself is beautiful, but it has a history. You're seeing Virginia Woolf here. This was a very popular spot with a bunch of, erudite people back in the day. So not just Virginia Woolf, but Bertrand Russell, E.M. Forster, you may recognize some of these names, and people that, were shakers and movers of their day. And so they have information there on what was called the Grantchester Group. And there's also a series now that's been filmed there called Grantchester. So you can, it's actually filmed there. You can see a church there that we could visit as well. It's open to the public and it's a lovely spot right there in Grantchester. It's right close to where we have lunch. Now, meanwhile, back in London, when we leave Cambridge, we'll start off at St. Paul's Cathedral. And this was designed by the architect Christopher Wren, who actually designed some of the building, about 50 churches in London, in and around London, but also some of the buildings at Cambridge. And I actually showed you one, but I didn't point it out, which was the Wren Library. But this is the interior. It's a beautiful cathedral. And you can we'll take a tour of the ground and then up into these upper levels of the cathedral, and then we can go up here, up many, many steps to be up here. And once we're up in this upper part of the dome, we can look out, and here's a picture I took from the dome, looking out. As you could see, this is one of the two towers. There's the clock. So I'm looking out at this from up here. I'm perched up here, taking that picture through this wrought iron O, or, well, it's not an O, it's actually, I just thought it was cool. That's the River Thames in the background there. So it's fun to go up in this and take a view, because you can get a 360 degree view of London by walking up. And of course, you feel like you've accomplished something when you go up all those steps. One of the things we'll also do nearby is the Globe Theater. We'll see a Shakespeare performance. We don't know yet what's playing there, but this is the Globe that's been, you know, reconstructed on a site not far from where Shakespeare's Globe was. We'll take a tour, we'll have dinner there and see a play. And then the day that we go to Downhouse, we take a train out of the train station we leave from is at the British Library. Now, the British Library has some of the world's most famous documents, including a copy of the Magna Carta. I think, I don't know how many exist, four or five today. That was, of course, written in 1215. A lot of basic foundation for human rights is in the Magna Carta, you'll remember from school. Also, they have some of Shakespeare's first folio editions and other things like original lyrics of, you know, jottings down of Paul McCartney and John Lennon when they were writing Beatles songs. And so they have a lot of cool stuff, paper, you know, documents on display. So it's a fun place to go, and it's free, and we get to go there. And then we go to Downhouse. And here you see some of the students standing in front of Darwin's house. The picture I showed you before was the backside out on the gardens. This is now an English heritage site, so it's preserved. It's a museum. And we will take a tour with the local guide of Darwin's greenhouse and his gardens. And of course, he wrote a book on orchids and insects and pollination. He figured a lot about that out, the biology there. And so that's, they have these restored with a lot of orchids. It's really beautiful to tour. And we also walk on his famous sand walk. This is what he did to think. He walked this multiple times each day. It's a big rectangle, and you can see how beautiful it is, and some of our students are walking it. It's a very rural setting, even though it's outside of London. It only takes us about an hour to get there. It's still very rural. And when Darwin, he would pile up a little bunch of stones, and every time he took a loop around, he would take his cane, his walking cane, and move one pebble from the pile. And sometimes his children would add the pebble back, so he would end up walking more than he thought he would. So I mentioned he was very much a homebody, very much a family man, and he was very, very close to his children and his wife. We'll also take lunch there. We'll have a separate special lunch. This is upstairs in Downhouse. This is the window, one of the windows we're looking out. You could see the wisteria here that you saw in that first picture I showed you. This is looking out on the gardens. It's remarkable how much material has been saved. So they know what was planted, how it was planted, the flowers and so forth, and vegetables and varieties. They kept track. Darwin was, I don't know, very meticulous. And I think the staff was as well. So they've reconstructed all of this. This happens to be an oil painting of Darwin as a middle-aged man. And you see, we're seated beneath it here at this lunch they provided us. So it's great fun to be, I mean, to me, a thrill to be in Darwin's home. And I think the students as well. And then we walk through the house, and there's a tour that we get there. Lastly, we, back in London, we will go to the Victorian Albert Museum. So in Kensington, there are a number of museums within walking distance of one another. One of the more famous is the Victorian Albert Museum, named for Victoria's husband. Again, one of the famous love stories of all time. She was absolutely devoted to Albert and he to her. And it was his brainchild to have a museum for the people, the citizenry, because back then people didn't travel very much. And so his idea was to have this museum, and they generated the funds to be able to erect this. And then later it was named in his honor, with Victorian Albert Museum, as it's now known, the V&A, as the locals call it. And it's just a beautiful place. And you're looking here at the outside, where you can, little kids play in this little kind of wading pool. But on the interior, one of the things Albert wanted done was to have casts made of some of the more famous sculptures on the continent and elsewhere, because, as I said, people couldn't travel back then as we do now. And so if you've been abroad, you probably recognize this, Michelangelo's statue of David, the young David, with the David and Goliath, in other words. This is a cast. The original, of course, is in Florence. And similarly, if you've been to Florence, you might recognize this is Raphael's painting of the School of Athens. So this is not the original. The original is a giant fresco that hangs in, I think, the Pitti Palace. I can't even remember now. It's been a long time since I was there, regrettably. But all of these are casts of famous things. These are, right here, these golden doors are casts of Bernini's doors of the baptistry in Florence. So anyhow, there's lots of stuff to see there. If you can't get to travel abroad, you can see casts of it in London. This too, now this is the original. This is Darwin's grandfather on his mother's side was a Wedgwood, was the Wedgwood pottery. And he did very, very fine pottery, and they have a ton of it there at the V&A. This is one piece, and you can see how elaborate it is. The fun thing for us to do there is take tea and have sweets or coffee or whatever, have a soda, a pop. And this is us sitting amidst these just luscious, beautiful surroundings. You know, you can be there in your jeans and nobody cares, but it's a fun place to visit. And to see all the artifacts. Nearby is the Natural History Museum. There we'll take a special tour, meaning we'll have a scientist who will take us behind the scenes. And it's a beautiful, beautiful building. It has all of these wonderful gargoyles around it. And you're seeing a picture of the main galleyway, I guess, of the interior. And but there, it's it has just all sorts of things, gems and fossils and, you know, so forth. And taxidermied animals, and, you know, you can learn about many, many things there. So it's a beautiful place, not just for the public, but it's where people do research, just like they would at our Smithsonian, say, you know, in Washington, D.C. There is a famous statue there of Darwin, which myself, and actually to give you, that was a scale thing, but our students took pictures of, and these are two of our students here, and you can see the Darwin statue up in the background. So it's a beautiful, beautiful museum to visit. We will also in London see the Linnaean Society. Here we're situated inside literally a vault, a fireproof vault. And this is where the Linnaean Society houses Linnaeus's books and collections. You're seeing here his insect collection. It's remarkable they've maintained this. It's still there. So, you know, the Linnaean Society procured it and they maintain it. And an archivist here is explaining to us about these holdings. So they take us back, they literally unlock the vault, and we're in here looking at things. Now, in the bigger part of the museum, we receive information, a talk by a historian of expert on, in this case, on Alfred Russel Wallace, whom you may know independently co-discovered this, essentially the same theory that Darwin hit upon of natural selection, evolution by means of natural selection. And so Alfred Russel Wallace is a co-discoverer, really, of the theory. And we're hearing here Dr. Baccalaureate tell us about Alfred Russel Wallace. He and Wallace and Darwin remain fast and good friends all the rest of their lives after this occurred. And here we're seeing a paper of Dr. Baccalaureate's on Wallace, but also Alfred Russel Wallace's notebook here. And that's what you're seeing strewn out, well, not strewn, placed out on among these holdings of the Linnaean Society. So again, those archivists, take those documents out for the students to see, and then they explain them. So it's, you know, very special, these behind the scene tours that we get to do. And by the way, Dr. Beccaloni is in charge of the Wallace Foundation. So that is what he does now. He is the director of the Wallace Foundation, where they maintain Wallace's place in history, do research on him, maintain his archives and so forth, generate funds to be able to maintain them. Also in London, of course, we go to Westminster Abbey, a famous, you know, again, medieval, dating back hundreds of years. Many of England's famous scientists and other notable people are buried there, including Darwin. That's his gravestone. Also Stephen Hawking, who died 5 years ago and was at Cambridge University, a scientist there. And also famous people. Here we're looking at Poets' Corner. We're seeing a memorial to Shakespeare and Keats and Shelley and others there, these famous people of the written word. We will also, now we used to go to see Phantom of the Opera, but alas, after 35 years, Phantom is closing its doors and we won't get to see that. However, we're thinking to go to the Mousetrap, which is in its 70th year. If you can believe that, it's, I actually saw this years ago. It's really good. And obviously it's still going on at St. Martin's Theater. It's a beautiful old theater. If you look that up online, it's fun to go to a London theater because they're smaller than the ones many of the ones that are in the US. So it's more intimate setting. So we'll do that. We'll go to dinner and see a live performance there. We'll also go to the British Museum, you know, one of the world's famous museums. And we would stay not too far from that in Bloomsbury. It's a lovely part of London to stay in, a neighborhood of London. At the museum, at the British Museum, you can see things such as the Rosetta Stone. This is the only place you can see the Rosetta Stone. And there is somebody, you can see a head there looking at it. And they have, of course, many, many other artifacts in the British Museum. Nearby is the National Gallery. They have, oh gosh, at least three big rooms of Impressionism. You're seeing here, obviously, a Van Gogh sunflower painting of the sunflowers. And nearby where we stay in London is the Charles Dickens Museum. So I went to this with a couple of our students. Dickens lived in this house for a few years, and you can go through on an audio tour and take tea there as well and have scones or whatever, muffins, some sweets. On the free day, one of the places you might want to go is Kew Gardens. We'll have a pass to be in zone 1 and zone 2. This is in a circumference around London. All of the places I showed you except Kew are within zone 1 and 2. And so you can travel freely pretty much on that 50-pound ticket on the tube, the underground in London, for that week. You might have to top it off at the end, add a couple of pounds, but Kew is one of the places to go. If you have an interest at all in gardens or horticulture, this is a must-see. This is one of the world's most famous gardens. And I'm showing you a map here. It's absolutely ginormous. It's a full day event thing to visit, but it's beautiful. But there are many, many other things to do. The reason we set this up at the end of the tour of the time there is that your classmates will have gone to different places and, you know, they can tell you about it. So there's that. And again, these hyperlinks will be on the sheet that Elizabeth sends out. So I think with that, I turn it over to Elizabeth. Thank you for your patience. That was kind of a whirlwind tour. And Elizabeth, please take over now. And do I need to share my screen so that, whoops.
Yeah.
So,
you can just leave yours up and I'll let you know when to,
I'm sorry. Can you do it now?
Yeah. You know, I closed the slides actually.
All righty. So I can advance them for you.
Yes, that'd be perfect. So I'll talk a little bit more about what the logistics of the program look like, but a couple of key things to point out. The program fee, we did finally get this set last week. It is $3,339. And I'll go into more detail about what's included in that in a couple slides. And then the application deadline is October 25th. So the end of the day, Wednesday next week. So you have all day Wednesday. It just has to be submitted by 11:59 p.m. You can go on to the next slide, Carol.
Oh, yes. So sorry.
That's all right.
Okay.
And then I think you already talked about this, the way the course is set up. So I don't think there's the one thing I will point out on this slide. Mm-hmm. If you are thinking about doing the course and you decide to enroll, just note that the spring class is planned to meet Wednesdays from 5:30 to 7:20. You won't be able to enroll in the course until after you've been accepted into the program, but that is true for everybody. So there's no worry about it filling up. That won't happen. But just as you're building out your spring schedule, keep your Wednesday evenings free so that you'll have that time available and keep 2 credits available as well.
And then, and here's the 3rd credit hour in the summer session. Okay. Mm-hmm. Anything else there, Elizabeth, before I move on?
Nope, you can move on.
All right.
So the logistics, as we've discussed, the program will be traveling to London from May 1st through May 13th. That's when you'll have that last 1 credit. You will be responsible for booking your own airfare. So we'll share with you, what the RD flights look like if you want to book the same flight to London as them. And then you'll have the flexibility to book your own return. So whether that means you do not want to fly in and out of Columbus because you're going to be somewhere else, or if you want to stay longer in London or travel around Europe a little bit more after, you'll have that flexibility to do so. And then the other thing I like to point out is we typically do hotel rooms for our accommodation. So you should expect to be in a double occupancy hotel room. So with another classmate from the program, it would not be a stranger. It'll be somebody from Ohio State. And we make those assignments usually based on gender as assigned on the passport. But if you have questions or concerns about that, that's something that we can always talk about leading up to either the application deadline or once you've been accepted and as we start to make those arrangements. And then the program is predominantly in London and Cambridge. So we can go on to the next slide. So cost. So if you go to the program web flyer, and I will send out a copy of the recording and the slides and the document that Dr. Anelli mentioned as well tomorrow morning. But on the web flyer, you'll be able to see a full breakdown of the cost of the program under the financial tab. But essentially what goes into it, you're billed a few things through the university. So all of these fees, except one, which I'll mention, will be applied to your summer 2024 bill. So you'd have that 1 credit, and that will be assigned to you based on your normal residency. So whether you're in state or out of state. So I have those 2 estimates on there. It's 386 for an in-state student and 1,183 for an out-of-state student. The program fee at $3,339, which is going to include all of your lodging in London or in the UK, breakfast daily in the hotel. The only day that breakfast isn't included is when you first arrive, because you'll have that overnight flight from the US to the UK. And they'll give you generally a snack on the flight. But depending on, the person, I rarely find that to be a filling meal. So you'll probably want to grab something when you first land in London. And then right now we have 7 additional lunches and dinners built into the program. All of your transportation within the UK. So like Dr. Anelli mentioned, we'll be giving you a tube pass to use to get around London on the metro. And then we have a bus to take you from London to Cambridge and trains to take you from Cambridge back to London and to Downhouse. So that's all included. With the exception of transportation back to Heathrow from the airport or from the hotel in London, depending on how you spend your free day, you might end up having enough on your metro card to get back. You might have to top it off. But that should, I think there's some transportation options that are like £5, depending on how you want to get back. And then all of the program activities and excursions, so everything that Dr. Anelli talked about is included in the program, as well as the international health insurance. So all of that is built into the program fee, which will be applied to your summer 2024 bursar bill. The 3rd item that goes on your bursar bill associated with study abroad for the summer is there's a $50 admin fee from the Office of International Affairs. And then the other expense you can anticipate is the application fee. So if you decide to apply, when you actually go to submit your application, there is a $150 application fee that needs to be paid with a debit or credit card when you go to submit. So that's kind of the only thing you pay to the university in advance of that summer bursar bill. So then what else might you have to pay for? You know, your airfare, your other meals, your transportation to and from the airport, personal expenses, a passport if you don't have one, vaccines, immigration fees. And I think if we go to the next slide, I have... Okay.
And Elizabeth, may I just say one thing?
Mm-hmm.
The breakfast in the hotel, these are what are called a full English breakfast. So if students can, my recommendation is you have a big breakfast and then you can have a light lunch. By full English breakfast, it means a hot English breakfast. So you can have, you know, eggs, meat if you're not a vegetarian, biscuits, you know, yogurt, like a full array. They even have sandwich meat and cheeses and fruits. And, you know, it's a huge, huge array that you can select from. So what I usually do is that. And then, you know, you don't have to spend time like sitting somewhere necessarily for an hour and a half trying to get a lunch. You can always just carry one if you wanted, for example, on a given day. So the idea there is you're already paying for your a full English breakfast, a hot English breakfast. So you may as well enjoy, you know, taking advantage of that. So
absolutely. Okay. Yeah. So this comes off of the cost sheet that's on the web flyer as well. So in addition to kind of having outlined for everyone the cost billed to the university, we try and give you estimates of what those other expenses will be. So the airfare, and I think I bumped this up from what like the actual flight I was seeing was to include like if you had to add some additional transportation costs to get back to Heathrow. The board you can see, so for those meals that are not included, and I would say this is usually a high estimate. If you do like eat a really big breakfast and then kind of have a lighter lunch or buy some stuff from the grocery store and kind of pack your lunches or get a quick sandwich and not a full meal, you could easily spend less than that. The books and supplies, this is a number that's dictated to us by financial aid. So as Dr. Anelli mentioned, there are only the four books that you need and probably a notebook, right? Because they do some journaling in.
We give them the journal actually.
So really $50 to $60 is what you're probably going to spend on books and supplies, not nearly the almost $400 that we have listed there. Similarly with immunizations, there's no specific vaccines that you need to go to the UK. They don't require anything for entry. So as long as you're up to date on routine vaccines, you likely won't need anything additional there, but you should talk to your primary care physician or a medical professional, you know, don't take my word for it. And just confirm that. So if you want to have that travel consultation, that's why we have the $60 built in. The personal expense is really for like budgeting for a cell phone. So it's roughly, you know, most cell phones are about $10 a day for an international plan. And then the passport, if you don't already have one, you would need to apply. If you apply now, you shouldn't need any type of expedited service. So $175 should be sufficient. If you wait to the last minute, I would bump that up a little bit because you'll need to expedite it.
And yeah, then Elizabeth, sorry, do you know how long passports are good for now? That, I mean,
10 years. So as long as you're over the age of 16, when you apply for the passport, it's valid for 10 years.
Thank you. Mm-hmm. 10 years. Yeah. Okay.
And then currently the UK does not require a visa or a visa to be applied for in advance before you enter. The UK, they have been talking about adding like an electronic visa. So something you'd have to do online before you go for probably about 10 or so US dollars. They haven't implemented that yet. And the information we're getting is that probably won't roll out until the fall. So I don't anticipate that will be necessary for the summer. However, the European Union is implementing a new e-visa process. They're calling it an ETA, an electronic transit authority or travel authority, something like that. But So if you are planning to do some travel after the program and you want to go out of the UK and into Europe, into the European Union, you will need to apply for that ETA before you go. And it's about $7 to $10. You do everything online. It's supposed to be a very easy process. It hasn't officially rolled out, so I don't know exactly what it looks like, but something to be aware of if you are considering that. So those are kind of the rough out of pockets. And I don't think I had the tuition turned on when I took this screenshot. So I can't remember if the $6,010 included the tuition or not. But that's roughly the program fees and kind of the explanation around that. You can go on to the next slide.
Okay.
So scholarships. So you can use most forms of federal financial aid, most university scholarships, grants, loans, towards the cost of a study abroad program. You have to be meeting the requirements of the aid. And so the reason I say that is federal loans, you have to be enrolled in at least half time. So you have to be taking at least 6 credits. So something to be aware of, but it's always worth kind of looking into and exploring, you know, what aid do you get? Can any of that be used towards your summer program costs? And that's a conversation you can have with Buckeye Link. They can help you look at what type of aid you get and whether or not any of that can be applied towards a summer program. And then we also have scholarships available specifically for study abroad. So if you're a student within the College of Food, Agricultural, and Environmental Sciences, we have a variety of scholarships that are specifically for our students doing our study abroad program. So as long as you figure, you fill out the general CFAS scholarship application, which is open right now. You want to fill this out by the program application deadline. So by October 25th, then we'll consider you for CFAS scholarships. The Department of Entomology is offering scholarships for their majors and minors. So if you're an entomology major or minor, the Department of Entomology has some funding. You're fine. The Office of International Affairs. So they house the study abroad office here at Ohio State. They have scholarships for students who are studying abroad. Their application cycle for summer 2024 will open this winter. So you'd be eligible to apply for those in probably late July, early February is my guess of when that will open. If you're part of Honors and Scholars, they have enrichment grants as well. If you did the STEP program, you can use your STEP funds towards the cost of this program. And then if you get a Pell Grant as part of your financial aid package, there's also a national scholarship called the Gilman, which is open to students with a Pell Grant who are planning to study abroad. And that their application cycle for summer 2024 will also open this winter. But if that's you and you have interest in learning more about that scholarship, or if you are the child of an active duty military member, Gilman has a kind of subset of funding called the Gilman-McCain. And I'd be happy to talk to any students more kind of individually about those if you have questions. Okay, you can go on. Eligibility requirements, pretty straightforward. You have to be enrolled as a degree-seeking student here at Ohio State, at least have a 2.5 cumulative GPA, meet Ohio State's general eligibility and conditions for participation, which is a long-winded way of saying you have to be in good standing with the university, so you cannot be on disciplinary probation in the same term that you study abroad. You'd have to enroll and complete the spring prerequisite course. And then just kind of the note that we do continue to monitor COVID, although COVID is having at this point almost no implications on international travel. So hopefully this time next year, I will have removed that note from the slides. But, you can go on to the next slide.
Okay.
So how to apply? You can get to our application from the Global Education website. So just globaleducation.osu.edu. There's a program search button. I usually just type Darwin into the keyword search and it's the only thing that pops up. Scroll all the way to the bottom and you'll see the Apply Now button. The application is pretty straightforward. It's mostly a bunch of documents to read through and sign off saying that you read and have understood the material. There is a couple questionnaires as well. So there's an application or an applicant questionnaire that asks you, you know, a little bit about yourself. And then I think it's like 3 or 4 short answer questions. You know, why are you interested in this program? How is it going to help you meet your academic or career goals? how are you going to be a good representative of Ohio State abroad? And so that's really where you get to tell us a little bit about you and what we look at as we're reviewing applications. So you don't have to write a long essay here, but you do want a good solid paragraph. So more than a sentence or two, but it doesn't have to be, you know, 3 pages or anything. And then you'll have to upload a copy of your advising report that you can pull off a Buckeye link. And then this is where you'll pay that $150 application fee when you're ready to submit your application. And then I think next slide. So kind of next steps, I always recommend discuss it with your support system. So your friends, your family, your academic advisor. They're a really good resource to understand how the credit may or may not, you know, meet a degree requirement for you, kind of how it will fit into your academic plan. Then make sure you apply. So as I mentioned, the application deadline is October 25th. And then also just being aware and considering like, what are those scholarships that you're eligible for? And checking to see if what the timeline is for those applications to make sure you don't miss any scholarships. And then make sure you apply for your passport. So the processing times change frequently. Right now it's about, I think it's actually 11 to 13 weeks. So it's taking a good, probably over good 2 months, 2 to 3 months to get those back. Yeah, more like 3 months. And then ask us questions. So I've got all of our contact information down there. There's a link if you want to schedule an appointment with me. And I think that is it. So
are there any questions in the chat or, and as Elizabeth said, you should reach out. Don't ever hesitate to reach out to any of us if we can answer questions. There was a lot of information here, and Elizabeth will make these slides available as well as the Word document with some active hyperlinks. But any questions from anyone?